1963, a high-tech factory was opened at Linwood in Scotland to manufacture an exciting new vehicle. The circumstances were somewhat unusual. The workforce was largely composed of ex-shipbuilders, the engine was based on an old fire pump, and the car was launched before it had been properly tested. Unpromising beginnings, but the little car duly emerged from the factory to greet an unsuspecting public. Perhaps they knew no better, for some less discerning drivers actually quite liked the Hillman Imp. And 30 years later, it still has its aficionados. So much so that 500 of them recently turned up at Helmsley in North Yorkshire for the Imp's 30th birthday bash. This must be one of the last cars to have a starting handle. But the bizarre thing was, it didn't come with the car. You had to write to the Roots Group in Coventry and buy one, which does seem to defeat the object somewhat. Yeah. Mind you, starting the engine was the least of your worries. Lying on its side in the back of the car, it produced an array of baffling problems.
Water pumps would fail. This would lead to the car overheating. Because the engine's all aluminium, when it overheats, the head tends to warp. And that's where the problems really start, because the mechanics of the day, really in their ignorance, they weren't familiar with aluminium engines, and they just used to strip threads. So it was, the damage was done in the process of fixing them, really.
When did you get hooked on imps?
I got my first car in 1980 after my O-levels, and never looked back since. There was actually a period of about 2 months in 1989, I think, when I didn't own one. I've had three ever since.
You don't ever get anybody sort of saying, well, haven't you got a proper car?
Almost daily. We do have a modern car, but this is the one I drive regularly. I much prefer it.
Of course, mechanical problems weren't the only worry that faced Imp owners. There were one or two peculiarities in the all-important area of handling, as I shall try and demonstrate. Not for nothing do the organisers call this little exercise the skills test. Now, one of the problems of handling was that on a wet or a greasy road or something, if you started to turn the corner, turn the wheel, put your brakes on, this is what happened. Fortunately, that wasn't a telegraph pole. Somewhat surprisingly, given the Imp's aversion to corners and a tendency to spin at the slightest provocation, the car performed remarkably well in international rallying. Never better than in the hands of Dublin dress designer Rosemary Smith, who won the prestigious Tulip Rally, no less. Rosemary, how difficult was the Imp to drive?
At the time, they seemed very difficult. They were a bit tail-happy, as you can imagine, with the weight in the back of them. But when you get used to them, I honestly think it's like any car. It doesn't matter what it is, you've got to get used to them. I found them great. And in fact, you know, I still find them great. I take them out sometimes, some historic stuff, and they're a super strong little car.
Do you think that the rally's success of the Imp helped in its sales?
Yes, to a certain degree, but unfortunately the road models weren't as good as the rally models, obviously, and they got a bit of a bad name, and I think that's why eventually they just sort of petered out altogether. They weren't very reliable as a road car.
Whichever way you look at it, for a small car, the Imp had some pretty big problems, so where's its appeal?
Very fast, very nippy.
And for me it's something like heaven to come here to England and see all these hundreds of Impsters here.
There was one round our road when I was quite young. I used to go out on my bike and stare at it, and that's how I sort of cottoned onto them.
They've done it. These Imp enthusiasts have finally converted me, so much so that I've decided to go home in one.